Hare Krishna. Welcome back to this last part of our discussion on the essence of the Bhagavad Gita. We discussed till now how love is the essence of the Gita and how a spiritual foundation of life helps us to see how our longing for love can be eternally fulfilled when it is directed towards the supreme spiritual reality, God. And then we discussed the essence of the Gita as manifested in four verses, 10.8-11. In this last session, we'll talk about how this Gita's message of love is demonstrated in the setting where it is delivered. By setting, we are not talking now about the war field on which the Gita was spoken. We discussed that in the first talk. Now we are discussing about the chariot itself. So, God is often thought as a supreme being to whom everyone else has to bow down. But the Bhagavad Gita reveals a dramatically different conception of God, where God is a charioteer. Charioteer is like a chauffeur. And now, how if we came to know that the President of America had become the chauffeur for someone, we would be amazed. Oh, we would expect that the President of America would have a dozen or more chauffeurs being ready to drive his vehicle wherever he wants to go. How would he become a chauffeur for someone? He'd be intrigued of what is happening over here. So like that, the Bhagavad Gita begins by describing, the first mention of God comes in the Bhagavad Gita, of Krishna comes in 1.14, where it describes that Krishna and Arjuna are Mahati Syandane Stitav Madhava Pandavaschaiva Divyav Shankav Pradatmatuhu. That Mahati Syandane Stitav, on a magnificent chariot they are situated. So, and Madhava Pandavaschaiva, the Bhagavad Gita is a poetry. And there are many beautiful poetic ornaments in the Gita. And one of those ornaments is is rhyming. So, Madhava Pandava, both Krishna and Arjuna have many different names, but here the first reference to them together comes in a poetically alliterative reference. Madhava Pandavaschaiva. And what do? Divyav Shankav Pradadmatuhu. They blow their conscience, divine conscience. So Krishna, who is the Supreme God, he has become the charioteer of his devotee. So this demonstrates that love, when directed towards God, is selfless. We do need to love and serve God, but that serving God does not mean that it's demeaning. The nature of love, when we talk about love, we say we fall in love. We don't say we stand in love. Why fall in love? Because when we love someone, we become so captivated by that person that we think, oh, you are so great in front of me, I am nothing. I will do whatever you want me to do. So most often what happens when people fall in love or claim to fall in love is infatuation. But the test of love is not how we fall in love, but how we stay in love. So the love is tasted not by the initial infatuation, but it is tested by the subsequent dedication. And dedication means we are ready to do what it takes to sustain that relationship, to deepen that love. And here we see in the Bhagavad Gita that God has become the devotee, that become the charioteer of his devotee. So Krishna is taking the menial position of a chauffeur for his devotee. Such is the sweet depiction, a sweet relationship between God and his devotees. And such is the relationship that we all can have. Because Krishna, at one level, the body is like a chariot for us, and Krishna is present as the chariot in our heart also. Ishvara sarva bhutanam hriddeshe arjuna tishthati brahmayan sarva bhutani yantrarudhani mayaya. Ishvara sarva bhutanam. That the Supreme Lord is present in the hearts of all living beings. Hriddeshe arjuna tishthati. He's situated in the heart and Brahmayan Sarva Bhutani, that all living beings, they're wondering, this Lord is guiding us. Yantra Rudhani Mayaya. Yantra Rudhani. We are also due to the machine and Krishna is guiding us. Like a charioteer guides. Similarly, Krishna also guides all of us. So now, the point is, how did Krishna become the charioteer of Arjuna? So at one level, Krishna shows his love for Arjuna by willingly taking the subordinate position of his charioteer. Now love, of course, is never unidirectional. To be truly fulfilling, it has to be bidirectional. So both people should love each other. So just as Krishna demonstrates his love for Arjuna by being there in his heart as a charioteer, so similarly, Krishna is present in the hearts of all of us also to to guide us. So he's directing the wanderings of all of us. And just as when Arjuna turned to Krishna for guidance, Krishna gave guidance and helped him to attain victory. So similarly, if we turn to Krishna for guidance, we can also attain victory in our life, attain success in our life, attain the supreme success, the supreme satisfaction of undying spiritual love. So now, when Krishna speaks, how has Krishna become the charioteer of Arjuna? That has happened because of Arjuna's choosing Krishna. Before the war, before the war started, the two opponents, the Kauravas and the Pandavas, started seeking allies among the various kings in different parts of different nearby parts. So both Krishna and both sought the assistance of Krishna. So Duryodhana himself decided to go to Krishna to seek an alliance with him, and then Arjuna also went. And when they came to Krishna's palace, both of them entered. Actually, Duryodhana came slightly earlier. And then he entered into Krishna's palace and they were told that Krishna is sleeping. So Duryodhana went and waited for him near his head. Arjuna came, followed him, and he went and stood near Krishna's feet. And then Krishna, after some time, opened his eyes and he saw, "Oh Arjuna, when did you come? Welcome." And Krishna got up and as he turned around, he saw, "Oh Duryodhana, you're also here. When did you come? Please come." And then he greeted both of them. And after initial greetings, he asked, "What can I do for you?" Duryodhana said that, "As you know, there is going to be a war between the Kauravas and the Pandavas, and I have come to seek your alliance." And then he saw Arjuna was also there, and he already knew that Krishna and Arjuna were friends. So he didn't want his interest to be jeopardized. So he tried to push his own interest by saying that, "Krishna, you know that I came here first. So you should fulfill my request." So Krishna smiled sweetly and he said that, "Oh Duryodhana, you may have come here first, but I saw you first." So there was Arjuna's humility which stood him in good stead. Rather than going and standing by Krishna's side, he stood by Krishna's legs, and that's how Krishna saw him first. Now Duryodhana was seething with annoyance at this time, but Krishna smiled and he said, "But still, I will try to help both of you." And he said, "Because I saw Arjuna first, and moreover Arjuna is younger to you, so naturally he should get the first chance to ask for something." And Krishna said that, "Because you are both related to me, I have decided I will not fight in this war. I will be on one side as a counselor, and on the other side will be my whole army, one Akshahuni Narayan Sena. And you can choose, you can choose whatever you want." And Duryodhana started burning in anger. He said, "Oh, I lost my chance. What will be the use of Krishna if the Narayan Sena is not there? Arjuna will surely choose the Narayan Sena, and I'll have to go back with this Krishna, who had also said that I will be unarmed and I'll be a non-combatant. I'll not fight in the war." So without any hesitation, Arjuna immediately said, "Oh Krishna, I choose you." And Duryodhana exploded with joy internally, but curbing his joy, he said, Oh, I guess then I'll have to settle for the Narayan Sena." And he took the Narayan Sena and he departed. Now Duryodhana does a comparative assessment of the two forces in the first few verses of the Bhagavad Gita. From the second verse, third, fourth verse onwards, he starts speaking till around the 11th, 12th verses. So there he describes the important warriors on both sides, but he misses out one person, that is Krishna. Because he thinks Krishna is a non-combatant, so he doesn't count Krishna. And yet, if we look at the Mahabharata war that takes place, Krishna, even without fighting, plays a decisive role in ensuring the Pandavas' victory. So Duryodhana represents the quintessential materialist, who thinks that material things are all that matters. And when somebody is not fighting, what is the use? He's simply calculating in gross worldly terms. Why is that person not fighting? That person doesn't count. But Arjuna is a spiritualist, is a devotee, and has a spiritual vision. And he chooses God over the world. And because he chooses God over the world, Krishna becomes so pleased. And Krishna says, what can I do for you? Arjuna says, please become my charioteer. And Krishna agrees. So when we choose God, when Arjuna chooses God over the world, God gives Arjuna the world. You know, God gives Arjuna the intelligence, the insight, the ideas by which at critical times throughout the war, he is able to make the right moves and he is able to attain victory. So similarly, in this world, when we turn towards God, when we devote ourselves to God, we may think, what am I getting practically? Is it going to give me some money? Is it going to give me some job? Is it going to give me some position? What am I getting tangibly? But actually, more important than the tangibles are the intangibles. We see that nowadays more and more organizations are recognizing the importance of stress management. Because they're recognizing that even if the employees are physically present with us for long hours, if they're mentally and emotionally disturbed, if they're stressed out, then they cannot function. So our productivity, our success doesn't just depend on our time or our ability. It also depends on our stability. And that stability, that inner stability comes by having a stable foundation to our lives. And God is that stable foundation. When we turn to God, when we devote ourselves to God, He is the rock that never shakes. He is the calm amidst the storms of the world. He is the shelter who never fails. He is the one whose love for us never dies out. So when we have that connection for God within us, then we can face whatever the world throws our way. We can face it with integrity and dignity and stability. And just as Arjuna eventually attained victory despite overwhelming odds against him, similarly, whatever difficulties we may face in life, if we choose God over the world consistently, if we stay devoted to God, then God will help us to weather whatever storms come in our life. And it is to reveal this message of love and to invite us to this life of love that Krishna speaks the Bhagavad Gita and that Krishna descends to this world on the day of Janmashtami to attract our hearts and lives to Him. So on this occasion of meditating on the essence of the Gita, we can contemplate how the Gita redirects and fulfills our deepest and strongest longing, the longing for love. Thank you. Hare Krishna.